Are you ready for the Low Blows Network?
Hello Dublin, you're very welcome back to the One With The Podcast, Season 3, Episode 9. Dublin parents, lock up your daughters, because we're back. I'm John, joined by...
Nathan.
And...
Yeah, I'm Amy. Lock up your daughters, really? Yeah. That's what you went with.
Bold of you to assume women listen to this podcast.
Well, I'm clean now, so back on the dating soon.
Oh, so we're admitting that for a brief moment.
Dramatization may not have happened.
100% happened.
Totally happened.
Yeah, so you're listening to the One With The Podcast.
I like how he seems like a real weird radio DJ, and then you're like, it's like easy listening. Mature voice.
You're listening to Sunshine 106.8. I love when taxi drivers listen to that.
That's one of my favourite radio stations. It's so fucking chilled.
No, but it's also like anytime I'd get into a taxi, like if I'd be out, like I'd be at like a shows or in the Three Arena or whatever.
After a night on the piss with all of his coke.
all of the taxi drivers, like I'll have a splitting headache and all the taxi drivers are listening to Sunshine and I'm like, oh, this is so pleasant. Then occasionally.
Sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows.
I just imagine that when Homer is listening to it.
The
dancing ice cream and lollipops that start to melt when the radio, like when the batteries start to go.
Okay, so there's our poll for this week. What's your favourite song about sugar?
I think it should be radio stations now at this point. It's like Sunshine.
What's your favourite radio station?
KABL is going to give me something stupid.
If you say news talk, you're getting blocked.
Derek FM is good as well.
So, for those of you who don't know what we do
been
here.
I'm trying to push classical FM on me because apparently PJ Gallagher does like a show on classical FM. Yeah, apparently. Just doesn't give a fuck.
So if you don't know what we do here, we talk about radio stations. we look at some of TV's greatest series through 2019 eyes, or wherever John is at the minute. John, where are you?
2008.
Oh, so we've gone up a year from last week.
So we're doing I'm Alan Partridge. We're on season 2, episode 3?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Brave Alan.
And that's a reference to what film, John?
Braveheart.
That's
a great movie, that is. Historically inaccurate, but a great movie.
Yeah, but like most of those movies always are.
I watched Troy last night and was like, yeah, great liberties taken with the story.
Do you know, actually, I watched for the first time and it's not a historical one. I watched fucking The Meg.
Yeah, I got a thing on my telly that was like, you should watch this, and it was like...
I'm not going to lie, I actually found it to be quite enjoyable for... Something just to like shut off.
It's Jason Statham versus a shark.
A giant like prehistoric shark. And they take it. Ruby Rose is fucking in it.
No, do you know what? That shark is the one that disappears in Jurassic World. Do you remember the first Jurassic World movie? He like leaves and then you never see him. Even in the second film. That's him. Yeah, it's a shared universe.
It fucking seems to be. But it's one of those movies where it's like, do you know what? It's very, very stupid. The premise is ridiculous, but it's actually quite enjoyable.
Yeah, but I love those films where you can go in and you can like shut up. Like that one that's coming out in a few weeks, Hobbs and Shaw, the Fast and the Furious one.
Yes, I'm looking forward to
it. That's going to be great. Superpowered Idris Elba versus The Rock and Jason Statham.
Yeah.
Great.
I liked it. That thing is, the Fast and Furious franchise is like kind of like a guilty pleasure. So it's like, no, because I can shut off during this and I can just enjoy.
But that was the thing. When I was like an edgy teenager is like, these aren't cinema. This is a disgrace. This is why real movies aren't made now.
Like, aren't you a bloke that like wanted to have like a podcast based on movies though as well?
Yeah. It was, well, that was based on bad movies.
Oh shit, I'm actually
to Bad Movie Tuesdays whenever it gets made.
Do you know what, actually? I really hope that you eventually get back to that.
Well, we have some ideas.
I thought it was a Butchie was doing it with.
No, I have an idea for a low budget slasher fixed. So.
Oh, actually, I'm into this idea even better. Okay, screw you, Nathan. Right, I'm actually into your idea a lot better. But I do recommend.
Silent Night, Deadly Night, Google it.
I have seen it.
Oh, the second one. Garbage Day. What a scene.
So let's jump into it. Alan is waiting impatiently for the Nesbitt sisters. What?
No. Okay.
Alan's waiting. Alan's waiting on the Nesbitt sisters to hand over so he can kick off his show about death. He puts on some deodorant as the theme for his show plays.
Puts on one side.
Yeah.
Because he can't get the turtleneck down.
He's wearing a chain with his turtleneck.
Turtleneck and chain.
Very right. Like the fashion. 97.
Oh, yeah. She let me wear my chain and my turtleneck sweater.
Turtleneck sweater.
So he begins asking how you want to be buried, and then reads an email where a 24-year-old says he wants to be buried with two page three stunners who are both still alive. Did you send in that email, John?
I was going to say, I have a hair in my notes. Like, is page three outdated? Like,
it's gone. Well, it's gone to a degree now. Now there's no nudity. It's just like bikinis.
Yeah, but like what kids can see in the internet, like, you know, I think was quite quaint. Like, you know.
Page three was my first experience seeing boobs.
Yeah.
Mine was looking in the mirror.
It was just we'd be in school on lunch break, and then somebody would accidentally open the front page of the Sun, and there would be boobs.
Well, that's the thing. Like, kids could fucking buy it. Like, you know.
Well, that's why it's gone now. Now yeah. It's just
put
bikinis.
Put smartphones and everything.
Yeah, but yeah. Well, at that point, it's on the parents. But like, if you're in a news agent and you are me, age like 14, 13,
and you could
whatever.
Already reach the top shelf where they had all the porno mags.
Yeah, I could probably reach them for everyone else back then. But nobody
to
would.
To be fair, though, you like at 13, I'd imagine you probably had like a 5 o'clock shadow anyway. So
no, I couldn't actually grow facial hair until I was like in college, nearly.
So that was the stress.
Yeah. Yeah, so how do you want to be buried, everyone?
Don't want to be buried, cremated.
John?
Well, there's going to be a difficulty finding my body because a psychic told me I'm going to be like strangled and stabbed to death by a jealous
I'm squanching here! I'm squanching here!
I want to be buried in my dream team jersey with Linda Block still alive there in the coffin.
She's going to be well dead before that.
Well, you never know.
Why is she going to be dead before that? I'm sure she's going to outlast John.
Like, that's the thing. Like, I'm going to die a violent death by like a jilted ex-lover.
The lesbians are really out to get you.
I know, yeah.
I do want to go.
I have to change my will as well because certain people were like left stuff and money. Like, so I was like, yeah, I don't want people having a stake in my death, like, you know, benefiting from it.
That means, Ali, you are out of the will.
I want
Dave,
to be swung around in my Tune Squad jersey.
Dun, 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 don't want to feel like have family feel obligated to come to a grave and like maintain it. So just cremate me, scatter me somewhere. Just that yeah, just get rid of me.
Like, that's only reserved for like people who like make an impact on the world. Oh my god,
can I actually be put into a, like a confetti cannon?
Actually, do you know what would be really cool?
And just like,
because I was talking about this the other night with someone. I want to have, I want to be turned into a record, like a vinyl record.
So we can just listen to you complain one last time?
Yeah. No, I want to have a, what was it? I wanted to have like two of the stupidest songs possible put on it. So it'd be like All Star by Smash Mouth and then Rasputin by Boney M.
Do you have like, alright, so do you have like songs picked? So do you know the way like, alright, so my thing is like being cremated and stuff like that. You get like, you're able to play like your own. You can either like pick the generic hymn that they have in the crematorium, or you can have your own song. For example, one of my uncles, he had Raglan Road was one that he went in, and then the other fella had Iggy Pop, right? Mm-hmm. I want Asia, Heat of the Moment.
I want Highway to Hell by
when
AC/DC.
When I'm like being burned, just like, but I don't want like, that the Asia version. I want the Cartman version from South Park when he's singing it, because I just think, you know what, let people go out with a laugh. And then when I'm being brought into the church, Don't Fear the Reaper, Blue Oyster Cult. I've just way too bad.
Yeah, The Shape of Things to Come by Bear McCreevy from the Battlestar Galactica soundtrack.
Nice. Very good. Yes.
Coming into the church, I have no idea what I'd want. But I know if I was being...
Oh, the Dream Team tune. And all the lads can put in here.
Oh, no, actually, no. Will someone have the Bill theme song and just everyone walking in?
How do you always come back to the Bill?
I don't know! It always comes back to the Bill or Dream Team. Yeah.
Please, yeah. UTV, ITV, sorry.
Bring back the bill.
Dream Team, like.
That was Sky One.
Yeah. Sky right. One, if you're listening to Peace Bomb.
Also, Sky One, while you're at it, please revive Gladiators. I love that.
Oh, yeah, God, please, yeah.
Do you know what I got recently? No, do you know what I got recently? I got the Sky One Gladiators Best Of DVD.
Shut up.
Yeah, I got it in the €2 shop.
Oh, fuck it, can we watch that later? You know what, screw the podcast. Someone get Gladiators.
Oh, yeah, we have a podcast to do. So...
We haven't started this episode yet.
Yeah, we did.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, so Alan quickly decides not to finish the email about the Page 3 girls and tries to read other emails but keeps looking at the page because the guy must have gone into a lot of detail.
I can imagine there'd be an awful lot of detail.
He also asks, what is there after we die? One person emails and talks about his his wonderful family and his new children, and then he says that there's nothing. And then we get the titles. So
I'm glad we got into the other conversation rather than get dug into this one.
So Alan finishes the show with a segment called Alan's Deep Bath, which is just radio ASMR. So he then had audio sensory meridian response. So it's the kind of
is that the thing where like when people are just cutting up bars of soap?
No, well, kind of. It's more
like the app, like people talking.
Yeah, it's more somebody would have like a microphone and they'd be like, "Hello.
Is there anybody in there?
This is a comforting noise for you all to listen to.
That's a more terrifying
on your lunchtime break.
That's like cover, oh my god, I'm gonna get murdered.
No, you'll have people will do ones where it's like they hold like something close to it, like they'll hold like celery and they'll like crinkle it in their hands near the microphone and stuff.
Yeah,
like
it is like people cutting the soap.
A little. So that's basically what Alan's is. So he then hands over to Dave Clifton, who he tries to slag off for having a fictional nightclub.
It's not the same fella from season one, is it?
Yeah. So Dave then tries to slag him off for having a fake bath.
She made me fall asleep in 1 hour.
Why did you give him the microphone for that?
Because I didn't know what he was about to say. John's looking up ASMR videos.
I'm gonna screenshot that for the Twitter.
So
I'm actually so glad he doesn't have access to the Twitter.
So am I. So Dave slags him off.
Did you actually just sulked?
When in doubt, turn him pow.
Dave slags him off for having a fake bath on his show, but Alan then makes fun of Dave for being in real clubs and being alone and calls him a saddo.
Doesn't he?
Oh, yeah. But he then falls at the final hurdle by messing up his words and then gets called out in it. Rule for life, if you're going to roast somebody, don't stutter or don't misplace words. Or if you're doing it by text, don't have a typo, because then everything you've said is just, he can't even type.
I love him. Like, this is like, you're just having like flashbacks to every time this ever happened to you.
Oh yeah, constant. I'll have like a really good point and I'll be like, I'm roasting this person. Then the next thing it's like, you spelled the wrong. And I'm like,
use the wrong there.
At the petrol station, Alan and Michael people watch as someone struggles to bring a pump around to their car, but they eventually do. They then talk about reincarnation. Michael wants to come back as a dolphin, but Alan thinks he wouldn't be smart enough.
You're wearing Slytherin socks.
Yes.
I've got my Hufflepuffs on.
I'm wearing plain black socks.
You can't sit with us.
While we're at it, what would you like to be reincarnated as, or who? I'll go first. A dog in a rich white family.
That's actually, yeah, pampered
rich
pet.
Rich white family?
Yeah.
I'm not going to lie, actually.
Like an American rich white family.
Coming back as a pampered pet would not be a bad idea.
Oh, do you ever see, Vanderpump Rules? And, like, the dog, like, gets flown first class. He's, like, 5 tiaras, all this shit. Gigi is his name.
Yeah.
And, like, he has a bodyguard and all, like, the dog. It's ridiculous. Like, he's so much money and so much clothes and stuff. It's like, I'd love to hold him hostage and just get a million off the bitch, like...
Jesus. I thought he was going to say I want to come back as that dog.
No, that wouldn't be a good life. Like, no.
I want to come back as a monkey and come to John's house.
Just knock on the door.
Pampered pet.
Or, you know, someone who like isn't suffering from crippling anxiety and just, you know, actually has their head on straight. I wouldn't mind coming back as that person.
I want to come back as just somebody well-rounded.
That
got dark again.
Yeah, Jesus.
Actually, do you know what? Forget it. I want to come back as the dog. Come back as a dog. Or a shark. Just the shits and giggles. Just, you know, just take revenge on the world. Imagine coming back actually reincarnating as an animal, but like having like a human memory. Just like,
there's lots of movies like that.
But like being just like, what it would be one of those things, like just imagine you're like a dog or a shark or something, just like doing your animal thing, and then all of a sudden
doing
just,
shark things.
You just kind of like stop suddenly because you have like a human memory.
Oh
god, that's
torn on huge.
No.
No.
That was the owner. It was the dog. Like he's trying to solve the crime with him.
There was one where like the dog came back. It was his dead partner to solve his own murder before he can get into heaven or something like that.
All dogs go to heaven.
There's a movie. Do you know what? It's a similar movie. It's this fella has like the brakes cut in his car and he dies and he comes back as a dog and the dog is called Fluke. And then he tries to find his family.
Was that with Chevy Chase?
It might have been.
And is that no? That's Fletch.
And the guy who cut his brakes is going to marry his wife. And he comes to the house and finds him. That, I think that might be the one you're thinking of. I love that film.
No, this is the one where he had to solve his own murder before he could get into heaven.
I'm still thinking that's All Dogs Go to Heaven.
No, it's not. No, it wasn't. It was live action, like, so that's how I know.
Right, Fluke movie was 1995.
Oh, that's older than me.
Ron Perlman was in that.
Was he?
Yeah. Along with Samuel L. Oh my god, Samuel L. Jackson is the voice of the dog.
I think he's the voice of the other dog who teaches him how to be a dog.
Rumbo. Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
That is, okay. Already, I'm sold on this movie. I'm curious now about the other one.
It's definitely worth a watch.
Yeah, imagine coming back like as a dog and then all of a sudden having a memory of being like, oh, do you remember when I fucking made a typo in that tweet? And then you just see a dog just standing in the middle of the road and his eyes are just going wide for like a couple of seconds.
So, speaking of reincarnation, Michael thinks Lynn would come back as a badger because he wants to hit her with a shovel because they carry TB. I love how Lynn and Michael just don't get along. They then spot a Lexus outside, which is better than Alan's, who explains that the plural of Lexus is Alexi. So, the man comes in. And is very like Alan, but is younger. The car, like, they have so many similarities. Like, the car, Lynx.
What flavours were they wearing?
Oh, Java and...
Voodoo. Yeah.
Right, a murder detective must avenge his murder after he's reincarnated as a dog.
What film is it?
Oh, Heavenly Dog.
Deadly.
1980.
See, that's why I wouldn't know it, or you, for that matter.
Yeah. So,
John Wood.
Fucking Chevy Chase was in it.
so you combined the two.
Ooh, we've made a connection.
I've done a 6 degrees without realising it.
6 degrees of separation.
So
I wonder if Kevin Bacon's in it. The dog actually was named Benji. Generic dog actor.
So the two lads are very similar. We're going nowhere with this show, lads. His name is Dan and he owns Kitchen Planet and is a fan of Alan's radio show. Michael suggests giving Alan a discount on his kitchen. The two swap jokes and then Dan offers to show him around and get a kitchen. They arrange for future drinks though without Michael, who says that he'll just get hammered alone. The next day we see Alan complimenting Sonia for classic intercourse in the caravan. She then offers him a plastic egg and a bap, which he sees coming, as well as telegraphing a whoopee cushion being put down where he's about to sit. Sonia is a prankster, apparently. She must have gone into a joke shop somewhere and just bought up all the like cheap kids jokes. She's stressed because she's going to have to cut carrot cake at work. And they say nurses have it tough. That's the joke in the episode. I'm quoting the episode. No.
That's a bit nice.
No. That Alan goes, and they say nurses have it tough. Jesus.
Well, we all know how fucking Nathan feels.
I thought you'd know me better by now. They ask...
Oh, Mr. Feminist icon here.
She asks Alan if Dan is going to be his friend. He says he's already his best friend.
Aww.
Lynn arrives unusually late because she couldn't find her keys and let slip that she was out for a curry last night with Gordon.
A new friend from her church.
Ooh. Alan then sits her down to launch into how he must be a con man or a bigamist and he's only after her money. She starts smiling and thinking about how she was stuck in the rain with Gordon, so Alan chastises her for laughing at the weather. Alan then takes a call from Dan, who wants him to present at the Norfolk Bravery Awards that night. Plus, we also learn that Alan nearly hit a badger on his way home. Sonia attacks Alan with a rubber hammer. He starts screaming and describes her as mildly cretinous. He's excited because it's the who's who of Norfolk, and then refuses Lynn's offer to come, but then has to take her up on it because Sonia threatens to tell jokes at the event. He then pretends to stab Lynn with a joke knife, but gets a nerve pinch for his trouble.
Yeah, she just goes straight for it.
She must. But I think she mentioned, like, in the last season that she had taken, like, self defense classes at some stage.
Yeah, it's like an episode of King of the Hill where, like, Bobby's learning it and he's like, I don't know you, that's not my purse. Then he kicks him in the balls.
Yeah. In the car, Alan gushes about Dave and making him laugh until Sonia starts with her jokes and pranks. They manage to distract her so they can throw her fake beard out the sunroof.
Sorry, about who?
What?
About who?
Who?
Who's he gush about?
Dan.
Dave?
Dan. No, I wrote Dave.
Yeah, that's why I was like, who the fuck is Dave?
I wrote Dave in my notes, sorry. Dan. What's the difference? It starts with a D.
Dan!
Well, yeah, we're getting there. In the car park of Choristers, Alan sees Dan from afar and shouts his name.
Dan!
12 times.
Dan! Dan!
And then gives up, only to do it one more
time.
But as he walks off, he keeps looking back. So, I think it's...
Did you see Lynn in the background? I think she's corpsing in it. Like, you know, when he's just like, Dan! You can just see her and Sonia corpsing in the background.
He probably just kept it going
Dan!
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 So that takes us up, I think, to our ad break. You're listening to The One With Podcasts, which is part of the Low Blows Network.
Really? Tell me more.
Well, the Low Blows Network is a network of podcasts where you can listen to things such as The One With The Podcast.
Ooh.
You can listen to Game of Low Blows. I don't know. We're recording these in advance, so I don't know if you're still doing Game of Thrones. Low Blows. You can also listen to Ask Low Blows and Paddy's New Yacht.
And
Talk Nerdy to Me with Jerry Saul.
I literally thought you had a woman.
Yeah, a woman just shouted from outside, and I thought she was here, and you locked her away.
I was like, proper, like, oh my god, he has her in, like, the wood. It's like she's gotten him.
Right, here we go, everyone. This is the brass tacks here. John has a prostitute locked somewhere in this house. If you want to free her, you need to send money to patreon.com/#lowblows. That is the word hashtag, not the symbol. Free John's prostitute. That's this week's hashtag. Hashtag free John's prostitute. Right. Okay, moving on. So, at the Norfolk Bravery Awards, Alan presents to Susan, a woman who lost her hand in a cake cutting machine, and then hailed a taxi with her hand in her hand, got to a news agent, who then kept the hand on ice in ice creams, using some Soleros, some Mini Milks, and a feast.
Mini Milks?
Yeah. Do you remember Mini Milks? They were like milk pops.
They were the cheap ones. Yeah, they're about 12p.
But they were lovely.
Oh, they were the best.
She then had her hand sewn back on.
But it didn't work.
But it wasn't successful. But 4 years later, she works in a bailiff's. So put your hat... So put your hand... give a hand...
Yeah.
Applaud like mad for Susan. That was brilliant. It's just don't put your foot in it and you keep doing it.
It's like that thing in Wayne's World. We're just going to cross the T's and dot the... lowercase j's.
Alan then awkwardly claps while he stands beside her after handing her her award. Later on, he sees single-hand Sue tackling the buffet and calls her a human JCB.
That was brilliant. I love that line. Like, I legitimately snot myself. It's like, human JCB.
Dachi, as well, it's the way the actress is actually doing it as well. Like, it is really...
She was probably told, like, use your hand like a scoop.
Yeah.
Like in my scary movie. In my good hand.
Take my strong hand. I was only watching that last night, actually.
The bit would have hit the black light on your mouth and fell over his face.
It's not even that. It's when he's like describing like how he cooks the turkey and he goes, I don't know what it is, but I lick it anyway. Oh, it's so disgusting.
Alan then heads over to see Dan, who is talking to some well-up Norfolkians. People from Norfolk.
Norfolkers.
Alan accuses...
We apologise to anyone from Norfolk that might be insulted by that.
Oh, wait till we get to apologies about Norfolk. I have stories. Alan accuses one of the people that they're talking about of hitting a prostitute.
John.
What was the line as well? Don't dress as a whore, he'll thump you.
He'll knock you down with his car.
They then talk about his trip to the toilet while the owner of Sexton's Garden Centre leaves. The woman who was with him is Dan's wife, Kerry. Dan asks her to give Alan a twirl, and then he turns into Paddy McGuinness and says, let the dog see the rabbit.
She's a bit of a ride, like, you have to give it to her. For a day, like.
Dead air. Somebody talk.
So you don't find a woman attractive now?
I wasn't really thinking of that. Yeah, I was.
It's not normally the first thing that comes to my mind when I watch any TV show. I want to bang her.
Yeah. I have a list.
We've seen it. John, send me a screenshot of your list and I'll put it up on the Twitter this week.
On the Twitter.
As in, the official, the Twitter, our Twitter.
The Twitter.
I'm not going to put it on my account. I'm not John. He calls it the Google and the Instagram.
It's just you said the Twitter.
Yeah, I mean, as in...
Not
the,
long ago.
Oh, sorry, the socials then.
There you go.
So...
Socials.
Alan gets awkward about Kerry twirling for him and having said, which one's the dog and which one's the rabbit? So they say that they're a big fan of his Alan's deep bath segment. We'll remember that for later. They then look at an old map of Norfolk and wonder whether or not it looks like a bum or a boob. For reference sake, I think it looks like a boob. If anyone cares.
John, do you think it looks like a bum or a boob?
I look like a misshapen boob, but still a boob. I like one of them old ones, you know, like orangutan titties hanging down.
Orangutan titties.
Anyway.
So the conversation.
My list here.
The conversation is then
a picture of orangutan titties.
No, that's gross.
The conversation's then.
Jesus
Christ. The conversation is then cut short because Karen Coleman of Coleman's Mustard walks by. She's the Grace Kelly with brown hair of Norfolk. Apparently. So Alan heads over to talk
is that
to her.
The same Grace from Princess Grace Blown Away from the Song. Well, obviously not. All right.
So
I don't think Princess Grace was shot like that.
One of them was. You know, and then I thought Princess the Fire Song. Princess Grace Blown Away.
I don't remember.
Like Princess Grace of Monaco.
No, the other one.
That was JFK Blown Away.
Oh, shit. I thought it was Princess Grace.
Oh, my fucking God.
There was a Princess Grace who was shot, though.
Do you remember when Princess Grace was driving through Texas and then got shot from the grassy knoll? Now both of them are Googling Princess Grace, and I'm sitting here and doing this on my own. So let's
just keep it
going.
Do you know what? You fucking love when you have all the attention.
No, I don't. I hate this. Alan,
yes, sir, didn't you want to become a fucking actor? You would have loved the attention. Come on,
yeah, but not like this. Alan then heads over to talk to Karen Coleman, but Lynn stops. What?
I thought it was Susan Coleman.
No, Karen Coleman.
Oh.
Karen Coleman of Coleman's Mustard.
Oh, yeah.
Alliteration.
What did he call her? A mustardess.
Yeah.
Just on this one here, Princess Grace actually had like a stroke at the wheel of a car.
No, that was another one though. From one of them shitty little Narnia countries. like, you know, one of these fake royalty ones and stuff like that.
John, Grace Kelly was the actress who married into royalty.
I know that, but there was a Princess Grace who was actually shot.
No, there wasn't.
There was.
No, there wasn't.
I guarantee you, there was.
If anybody knows of the Princess Grace who was shot, please send it in. Because we're never going to finish this otherwise.
Get back to your muster list.
Yes. So Alan tells Lynn to make sure Sonia doesn't have any stink bombs on her. He then awkwardly hangs around a group of people that Karen Coleman is talking to.
Again, no, there's not.
He tries to make his presence felt.
I'm Googling a fucking name. There's not. There's no other Princess Grace. There was no Princess Grace that was shot. Okay? End of. She had a stroke at the wheel of the car.
I know it wasn't her, that one. John, the world famous one. There's not.
Oh, right, so the Narnia country. Are you sure you're not thinking of a fucking movie?
No, it was one of them African...
That's not a Narnia country.
It
John.
Is. That's what I refer to. Narnia country. The Narnia country.
I don't want this recorded.
I do. Okay. How about we all just come back to this afterwards and we'll just continue with the show.
Yeah, okay.
So he finds a woman in a wheelchair and pushes her over to make his way into the conversation. Once successful, he pushes her away. He pushes her over to somebody else. Then she comes back so she can have a chat about Karen, about a project, which excites Karen, who goes to grab drinks. He then pushes her away as far as he can and asks, would she be brave enough to let him finish his conversation? Karen returns and asks Alan how, or she asks, oh my god, Karen returns and Alan asks her how she feels about things like Tabasco and soy. The topic then turns to the bravery of people in attendance, as well as people who are brave like Evel Knievel and Braveheart.
Yo, title drop.
Alan mentions Karen's bravery, but she says that she's not really that brave, she just fundraises and helps people with mental health charities. Alan says he avoids mental health so as not to get tired with the mad brush. She then tries to leave until he says that he has his own mental health problems, which she says she should have realised and she had a feeling about it at first. Jesus Christ. He then tells her about the time he drove to Dundee barefoot after buying the rights to K9 from Doctor Who.
He would have made a fortune if he really did that.
Now I think you'd make a fortune if you did
that's
it.
That's what I mean. Like,
oh yeah. Back then, Doctor Who was worthless. So Dan arrives.
When was Doctor Who rebooted?
2005. So this
well,
is
then
years.
You had the Sarah Jane Avengers as well, and then
but that was good, and they had K9 in that.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Yeah, all that merch money. Oh yeah,
I used to have like a K9 when I was
did
a kid.
You?
Yeah, it was like a remote control.
Is it opened?
What do you mean?
Like
it was when I was a kid. It was a toy. I had loads of Doctor Who toys as a kid.
Nerd.
So Dan arrives and tries to jump back onto the Norfolk boob talk, but and then outs Alan for sucking up to the mustard heiress. They then have a back and forth about arrests and shootings because they're so similar as people until Alan says that he has Dan's kids. Dan walks away, as has Karen Coleman. So this is where I was going to say there was a problem with this episode. The mayor of Norfolk at the time didn't take too kindly to the show making out that everyone from Norfolk was essentially like worthless in a way. It was the thing about the man who owned the... He owned a car manufacturer or something. Him thumping a prostitute. There was the thing about the man who owns the kitchen place being a sexual deviant. There was the fact that the only kind of industry they seem to have there is the mustard industry. He didn't take too kindly to it, and they had like a big thing over it.
Is Coleman's mustard actually from Norfolk?
Yes.
Okay.
And while we're on the topic, in 2017, so Karen Coleman isn't actually real. The actual heir to Coleman's mustard was a man named Jamie Coleman, who funnelled hundreds of thousands of pounds to a barrister at the centre of a child abuse scandal, knowing that he had brutally beaten teenage boys.
What?
Yeah.
So don't buy Coleman's mustard, yes.
Shut the fuck up.
This was from The Telegraph in February 2017. Jamie Coleman, who will become a baronet upon death
so
of his father.
Else?
He's someone to do at wrestling.
Oh, Jesus.
Sir Michael Coleman used a charitable trust to send donations of £12,000 a year to John Smith QC, who is accused of abusing teenagers in Britain and Zimbabwe. So,
ooh! Oh my god, are you fucking for real?
Yeah.
So, oh, we're getting rid of that shit over our house.
Because I knew
there was a reason I hated mustard.
I had to Google it, because I was like, is Karen Coleman real? And then I found out, not only is she not real, but the people of Norfolk hate Alan Partridge, and also the real owner of Coleman's Mustard. But while we are at it, Coleman's don't actually own the rights to Coleman's anymore. It's owned by Unilever, so.
No.
So.
Okay.
And it's not that bad. Anyway.
Have you ever tasted mustard?
I quite like mustard.
Yeah, it's wild.
You sick bastard.
I like spicy things. I love spicy things.
That's not spicy though. That's just rank.
It stinked off it.
Oh, it's so strong. It lingers in the nostrils and everything.
That was the worst job on fucking me and Johnny Dram. He used to work in a pub. Like, you have to put all the fucking the old mustards into the new one. So you'd have to scrape the shit out of the bottom. Like, so it'd be like, oh god.
That's a weird job to do in a sex shop.
Oh, halfway house in Walkinstown. Don't eat your mustard from there unless it's in a packet. Oh, I might have packed your mustard here actually.
Oh, for God's sake, John, just come back. John has an Iron Man head that I think was supposed to be.
It's a cookie jar.
Yeah, it's a cookie jar. John has a packet of mustard here.
Blenders English mustard. Something English.
Nathan. Eat that.
I'm not eating mustard sitting eating the podcast. Yeah, probably is. Right. So now you know why people in Norfolk don't like Alan Partridge. So he spots Sonia talking to Karen. Karen wants to help people like Sonia to achieve residency in the UK, but Alan says, just judge each case on its merits.
Yeah, so that won't fly anymore with Brexit, like.
Sonia is then invited to a girls' night at Karen's. Sonia then takes out gag glasses, which Karen finds hilarious. Then to compete with Sonia being funny, Alan eats a spoonful of mustard.
Oh, that was disgusting.
Karen then says she's going to give Sonia a number for someone for Alan to talk to as they leave him alone.
Yeah.
So everyone's now left. Lynn is heading off with Gordon, so Alan spends his evening in the arcade alone. He then goes to the garage to find out Michael's not working that night, so he goes to Michael's house. Michael keeps him at the door and offers him a cup of beans with a sausage. That was way too quick. The beans and sausage are either cold or not cooked, or they were already sitting out. He like walks in and then pulls them out.
Do you have an issue with cold beans?
Yeah, I have an issue with beans generally. I don't like beans.
Really?
Yeah, I hate. You hate beans.
You'll eat mustard, but you won't eat Heinz beans.
No, I hate Heinz beans. I hate all beans. Beans are awful. Well, no, actually, I don't hate all beans. I hate like baked beans, tins of beans. I don't mind like.
What about a burrito, pinto?
Oh, I love them. I love refried beans. I love black beans, pinto beans. I hate baked beans.
Why?
Just don't like them.
That used to be like the only way I'd be able to eat like mashed potatoes. Yeah, do you ever get when you mix like the beans and mashed potatoes together?
That's like the worst thing in the world to me.
I feed that to Noah all the time. That fucking little kid goes crazy for that shit.
So he has his beans. He's leaning around the door trying to watch a documentary about triads. He then closes the door and leaves Alan outside on his own and tells him to just leave the cup on the doorstep. So Alan calls Lynn from outside Dan's house and tells her to bring the kitchen brochures. Inside, Dan heads to get Alan a drink while Kerry chats to him in a kimono. She starts stroking his leg and talking about the evening. He then moves away because she's moved too far up his leg and is touching his privates. He moves away as Dan comes in. He has a video of kitchens for them to watch. It's not actually a video of kitchens. It's a sex tape set in a kitchen starring Dan and Kerry. Alan tries to ignore the sex and talk about the kitchen, but they keep trying to bring it back into the sex.
He's talking about like the worktops.
Yeah, he's like, that's a good granite worktop. Yeah. And it's like, MDF, that's illegal in America. And then Kerry shows the sex act and goes, so is that. Which I want to know what it is. Just out of interest.
Trombone or something like that.
I don't know if that's illegal in America.
It's just,
I think they probably invented it.
Anyway.
Well,
that's one of your cards against humanity, isn't it?
So, yeah, Lynn then arrives and is offered a drink and sits down. Alan puts on the tape to show Lynn that they're swingers and they need to leave. Lynn says to Dan that she doesn't want to be part of their sex festival and heads out, which even Alan is kind of like, couldn't have phrased it anywhere.
Yes, I love that as well. He's like, when he's playing it to her and he's like, don't make the noises they're making.
Yeah.
He puts it on.
Ooh. It's like, stop it.
So Lynn heads out. Alan is blunt and says to Dan, I don't want to shag your wife, although by the promotional video I'd imagine I'd have a ruddy bloody good time. Kerry then asks for a quick hug. Alan obliges but has to push her away and says, don't rub your fanny on me. She then says she's looking forward to his deep bath later on. So later on in the studio, Alan quickly goes through the segment as non-centrally as possible, saying that it's you're going to pick up her loofah, it's going to be rough, it's going to hurt, you're going to then blast the scum off of your bath afterwards with the shower head. And now the segment is cancelled and they'll never do it again. Dan and Kerry are seen listening, shocked. Alan then has flashbacks of his entire day to end the episode. So that's, yeah, that's that. What did everyone think? Amy, we'll start with you.
I'm just laughing at Lynn now at this point, just since she's on the couch. Ooh. Oh, don't make the noise. I like the episode, and I always thought it was, I just... some bits of it, like, especially with Sonia, is the fact that she's more, like, accepted by everyone than, like, Alan is. I just love that, and he's just like, oh, come on. Like, especially with the glasses.
Yeah.
What does she go, what did she say?
My eyes, they fall out.
Oh,
and then Karen starts laughing
at it.
And he's like, see what I have to put up with.
And he's like, oh, do you find this funny? Okay.
So yeah, so you enjoy it?
I enjoy the episode.
Any memorable quotes?
I don't
other than them. Like
just laying on the couch.
Just laying on the couch.
That and like the death talks. I'm just like, because it led
that to, seems like years ago now.
Yeah, and it led to a conversation with us. I think it was this episode. Can't remember.
So John, any thoughts on this week's episode?
Yeah, I liked it. So my favourite line of the episode, Alan describing the sex tape. It's like a hardcore Benny Hill.
Yeah,
very good. What episode?
Was there any like forms of comedy that were in the episode that you quite enjoyed?
Maybe there was a bit of physical comedy, perhaps. Yeah.
How would you describe that physical comedy?
Gratuitous. Yeah. Physical comedy, gratuitous.
Someone's been reading the dictionary. How else would you describe it, John? John, just say the fucking word. Come on.
No, how principle.
Say it.
Say it.
Only if you say.
Come on, John.
The M word first.
What's the M word?
You fucking know. Do you know what fuck it's not worth?
What's the M word?
Moist.
Oh, come on. It's a good trade off. Go on, say it.
It actually makes me physically ill.
Just pretend you're talking about like a Madeira cake. And not a fanny.
How do you get your Madeira cake?
Oh, moist.
Okay, she said it now. What was their good things in the episode of?
Slapstick!
Yay! Yeah. I feel dirty. I feel like a whore. I feel like I've been used and I'm just like John's couch now. Just wasting away.
Or the woman who's apparently locked in the back. I really enjoyed this. I don't know what it was. Maybe I'd seen clips of it recently on Twitter or something, but like I was quoting along with this episode, like word for word. And I don't know whether it's just I remember it really well or I'd seen some of it recently.
Was the shitstorm recently or when it aired about Norfolk?
Oh, it was in 2002.
Oh.
But the thing about
no internet back then, no one even knew what the fuck Norfolk was.
It was the I found the article.
John, no, it's a fucking place in Narnia. Yeah.
I think it was an article that was in the Guardian at the time. So it was like the mayor of Norfolk was like, we don't like Alan Partridge because
was that the newspaper that you got in prison? Was it the Guardian?
No,
Telegraph.
I had to find this online, but when I found it online, they also had like a thing where they were having like a big event and they were like, are you going to invite like Steve Coogan or Alan Partridge? And they were like, he can watch it from home. So they're quite salty.
Do you know what the funny thing about it is, though?
He put them on the lamp.
Exactly, yeah. It's when shit like that happens, you actually get eyes on you
for
it. So, do you know what? Be grateful, Norfolk.
Did the pedestrianisation ever go through?
I don't know.
I need to check that.
There was a quote on TV Tropes or something like that, and it was like, pedestrianisation did in fact go through, and there was nowhere near as Alan Partridge predicted.
Oh, well now we know.
Yeah.
Amy, well, there's no need to look it up.
To be fair, though, it's John saying that, so...
That's fair.
Cameralization may not have happened.
Exactly. Yeah, so the pedestrianisation of Norfolk City Centre actually was approved despite Alan Parkin's opposition. That's actually...
Do you think they did it out of spite?
Do you know what the big thing is? It's actually, that's legit the headline on The Independent. Despite Alan Partridge's opposition. The Steve Hugan character was famously against it. Oh, you motherfucker.
You have to subscribe to finish the article.
Oh, you fucking bastards! Yeah! Why?
Paywall! News should be free!
News should be fucking free! Yeah, you wanks! Fuck you, Independent.
Okay, well...
Well, they can keep their Independent when they fuck off every European bastards.
They're never fucking leaving.
Okay, well, that takes us up to the end of this week's episode. Until next time, I've been Nathan.
I've been John.
Sorry.
Dan!
Oh, it's not
you
Dan.
You sound like you just had sex with a man called Dan.
I don't think he's heard me.